the most important element of this disruptive event and this pandemic will be how we rethink the trade-offs between cost and responsiveness. When we teach about supply chains, we basically talk about many of the companies look for the cost-effective solution. They're chasing the lowest per unit cost of the good. That sends them over to Asia or low labor costs for their manufacturing. They also send their goods via ship, which can take weeks to get back to the US. And these are all focused on building a supply chain that's extremely cheap in order to produce goods that are sold for low prices. But what we challenge our students to do is to think about what's the flip side, what's the value of being responsive? And I think right now we're living in a time where we see very clearly the value of being responsive. And by being responsive, I mean shortening the lead time. So we see AirBridge, for example, FedEx working in conjunction with the government, air freighting goods from factories in Asia to the US to cut the lead time down from weeks to several days to get masks here, gloves, PPE, et cetera. But I think what we need to be thinking about is it's very easy to identify the costs of a supply chain because I have data on the labor, I have data on the raw material. What's really hard to estimate is what's the value of responsiveness. So we teach our students basically how to value that responsiveness. We teach basically how do you estimate this? How do you estimate the cost of being understocked or the cost of having extra inventory? And those are metrics that are often more noisy than the cost metrics. And so there's a lot more assumptions that go into the value of being responsive than need to go into assumptions for the cost side of the equation. So we tend to overemphasize cost at the expense of responsiveness. And that's what we've seen in today's supply chain. And that's part of the problem that we have in this situation now is that we don't have agile, resilient supply chain for some of the goods where we ought to have had them in place. I think supply chain managements will think differently about how they value agility, whether or not they're willing to pay a little bit more to have a contract with a vendor that might be able to go online quickly if need be. I also think we're going to see, my expertise is in the retail space, and I think we're going to see some additional adoption of robotics way sooner than we might have otherwise. So if you go into a distribution center in Europe and in some parts of Asia, most of them have extensive robotics and automation in their distribution centers. We don't have that in the US, although this pandemic has actually caused us to think differently about that. And we see some speedy rollouts of such automation within the retail space. Walmart, for instance, is rolling out a robot that can actually count items and help with replenishment. We see another company having automation within their fulfillment centers to help pick and pack goods to the end consumer. So I would imagine that those types of investments will happen in the supply chain more rapidly than we might have seen otherwise. We've seen this really big spike in consumer goods and we've seen this depletion in demand for durable goods and industrial products. And the result for that has been pretty large in the apparel industry. So we see a lot of displacement of workers in the apparel and fashion industry in Bangladesh and in Cambodia. And you know that will be a concern moving forward. So that's some of the supply chain issues that I see on a global basis. That's just not specific to us. But as our spend goes down for things that we don't really need, maybe you know a new jacket or a new pair of shoes, we see displacement of workers. I think the textile orders were down by 35%. Imports were at a 5-year low. So these all have implications for the long run supply chain. And then also in those industries, how quickly they can ramp up again